Hello friends, welcome back to our virtual lab. We are but two humble scientists trying to do our best to rank every Atari 2600 game ever made, asterisk, not including some of the newer homebrew stuff, but the vast majority of them. My fellow scientist Mike is here.
What's up guys? Also not gonna do those stupid porn games, fuck those games.
Yeah, the porn games all tied for last place, scientifically speaking.
Yeah, they're dumb.
Yeah, thanks for the reminder. I'm sure some people are new to the series and maybe curious about that, but no, you don't have to worry about that bullshit. How you doing?
I'm good.
Good.
Excited for another week. Excited to see if we can maybe get a new number one or maybe a new... number, let's see, what would it be, 72 maybe?
Yep, at the end of this this episode we will have 72 games on the list, and there's a pretty good chance that Springer will still be the number 72, the worst game of all time. It's been a while since we've seen a game as low quality as a Springer or a Title Match Pro Wrestling.
Yeah, the Mr. Dew's castle was pretty damn close, but
not
as bad.
Yeah, it was playable, which is more than you can say about the bottom one, two, three, the bottom five, I would say, are
sure.
So broken as to be unplayably bad. But hey, you know, we still have over 400 to go, I think.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I'm sure we'll find something that is worse than Springer. It has to be possible. Go ahead.
Go ahead. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, it's okay. Yeah, we're doing this over Discord, so some latency is inevitable. My apologies. I was just going to say we had a couple bangers last week.
Absolutely.
Escape from the Mind Master, just mind-blowing. You know, some may say it's not a pure Atari 2600 game because it requires a separate accessory. But I think we have to take those into consideration. I mean, the StarPath Supercharger was... I found an ad for it at the time, and it was $60, which is, you know, not inconsiderable, but also... not more than the cost of some of these games, I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, even if you go by like the what was the normal cost of a game for the Atari 2600 back then, that's two games. That's not that bad.
Yeah, and I think it must have come with a game, right? I don't think they would have sold
I'm
it.
Sure. Yeah, I'm sure it came with a game or something. They probably didn't sell it by itself.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I mean, I think those are all fair game. I was reading up about it. It was a really interesting thing. They sold a CD like in the 90s with all of the audio data from all of the Supercharger games, so you don't have to load it from a cassette tape. You can use a CD player.
Yeah.
And the name of the CD was Stella Gets a New Brain.
Stella Gets a New Brain. Interesting.
Yeah, Stella was like the original code name of the 2600, and they did indeed give it a new brain with their thing. And I look forward to exploring those games in the future. But in this episode, we just have six totally normal Atari 2600 games. Nothing, you know, no Supercharger games, no paddle games, no weird controllers, just six straight-up games.
Yep.
And we're going to start with your first game, which is Megamania.
Yep, we're going to play some weird space nightmare game by Activision.
Yes, Megamania, a space nightmare.
So this one's fairly straightforward. It's a bit Space Invaders. You by default you have the ability to aim the laser you shoot. Ah, fuck. and if you get shot, obviously you die. It's fairly straightforward.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any like bosses or anything like that. It does change, you know, what you're shooting each round, and it gets harder. They move faster.
Yeah. And they move in different patterns.
It is very easy to not shoot them and die because they land on top of you.
Yeah. So you seem to be piloting the Starship Enterprise here.
That's what it seems like.
The enemies can wrap around the screen, but the Enterprise can't. So that makes it kind of tricky when they get to the bottom of the screen and you don't really have anywhere you can go.
So you do have a bit of a time limit. That's what your energy bar is.
Right.
We're about to find out if I run out of energy here, because I cannot, for the life of me, shoot these last two guys. There we go. So there's a different, if you change to, I think it's game mode 3, because it's 1 and 2 player, is one and 2. And then game mode 3 makes it to where you don't have control over the lasers. Ah, shit. They just fire straight. So they aren't aimed.
Yeah.
I would imagine that is a more difficult version of this game, but I don't know. I just use the ones that you can aim.
Yeah, I'm digging the steerable lasers. That makes this feel a lot more manageable. Especially I'm on a wave with like tiny little disc things that are spinning around, and the steerable lasers definitely makes it feel like you don't have to lead them the same way you would with such a small fast target in a normal shooter. So that feels pretty good.
Yeah, it's also one of the few games that I know of on the Atari that you can just hold the button down.
Oh yeah,
have to pump it.
That's true. And it's one shot at a time on screen, like a lot of these games. But the shot seems pretty quick.
Yeah, it's got quite a bit of speed to it. There's no music, which is, I think, probably unfortunate, because the noise of you shooting gets a bit grating after a while.
Yeah, a bit.
The sound of you winning the level and it, like, getting the, draining the rest of your energy as points is pretty good, though.
Yeah.
And, like, it filling it back up, that's pretty good, too. Those aren't bad. So have you played this game before?
I don't think so.
This is one of those games that a lot of people have played.
Yeah.
Ah, shit.
Yeah, like many Activision games, this is one that a lot of people remember fondly.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. So I loop back around to the first ship type, like the flying saucer things. But they are behaving differently. Like they are, like they're stopping for a second and then zooming, resuming their pattern, but much faster.
Oh, interesting.
Hey, extra ship.
I got shot. Oop, I got shot again.
Ah.
Discs.
Oh, yeah. Ah, I keep running into these girder things. The second pattern is quite a bit more difficult than the first pattern.
Whoa, these guys are nuts.
Yeah, a lot of interesting enemy types in this.
Okay. I might be screwed. Yep, I gotta take one for the team there to be able to. This particular pattern that they like go down in a like a Z, but they also like move back and forth.
Oh yeah,
like a weird like girder. They look like flying cars or something.
Ah, yes.
Shoot, I died the level after those. I don't know what the heck that was, like weird flickery V-shaped things.
Oh yeah, like I just got a game over 37,000 something points.
Holy shit, you did way better than me. I only had 19,000.
Dang.
So yeah, go ahead.
Oh, I like that the energy bar, like, it doesn't seem like it's a high pressure time limit. I haven't like come close to running out of energy. But it's kind of there to encourage you to not dawdle, that's fine.
Yeah. There doesn't appear to be anything else really to it. Only the ways will return for a rematch. The better you get, the better they get. The shapes will be the same, but the colors will be different. The objects will take on more sophisticated motion patterns and evasive actions with each new cycle. Each of the enemy objects travels in an orbital path. When the object disappears off the bottom of the screen, it will return at the top of the screen.
Any lore as to what these things I'm attacking are?
So, let's see. What we got? What's this? You control a fleet of mobile blasters at the bottom of the screen under constant attack by wave after wave of outrageous objects.
Oh.
The goal is to accumulate points. Yeah, it doesn't even attempt anything in the story.
Oh-ohs. Outrageous objects.
Yep. It lists them as the hamburgers, the cookies, the bugs, the radial tires, the diamonds. That's the little flickery diamond guys.
Mm-hmm.
The steam irons. That's like the floaty car looking thing. The bow ties. That was the level that I died on. And then the space dice.
Ah. Yeah, the last wave looked kind of like space oysters from Oystron.
Oh yeah,
but I guess they were dice.
I didn't get that far. But yeah, that's it. That's the game.
Like, yeah.
Hamburgers. This appears to be a fairly simple arcade game.
Yeah, outrageous objects.
It's a bit like Space Invaders, but quite different because of the different objects and the different momentum and movements and being able to control your laser. Firing much faster, too.
Yep. Yeah, nothing to hide behind, which it wouldn't really work in this kind of game because the objects are kind of moving up and down as well as left and right.
Yeah.
Like, it's nice that the game doesn't immediately end when one gets to the bottom of the screen.
Yeah. I would lose on the second level every time because I always those guys always have to rotate. Oh shit.
Yeah.
Have to rotate once.
And I think I got in the same unwinnable situation that you did on the level with the. I guess the hamburgers, where they were, like, there was a vertical column of them that was just, like, it didn't seem like there was a break in the column at all that I could get into to start shooting them. Like, I just, I basically had to die, and, well, that was my last life, but, yeah.
Oh, crying.
So, it is possible to get into an unwinnable situation with some of these patterns.
Which, that's interesting, and I don't know if that's necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah, you just have to be mindful, and, you know, you have to, you know, learn the patterns and try to prevent that situation from arising.
Yeah.
And if it does happen, when you die, they all kind of start spawning again from the top. So,
yeah.
As long as you have an extra life, you do have a chance to redeem yourself.
Yeah, it definitely, you aren't, like, forever screwed in that situation, thankfully.
Yeah.
Oh my god, I keep getting shot by dumb stuff.
Yeah. Like, when you're trying so hard not to let them get to the bottom of the screen, it can be easy to lose focus on the shots. You kind of have to split your attention.
Ah, son of a... That was one where I was trying to shoot the thing and just move directly into the thing shooting me.
Yep.
That's super, super intelligent, let me tell you.
You were outsmarted by the advanced extraterrestrial AI. Shit. I got shot by a bow tie.
At least I shot you and didn't just like, son of a bitch. Like, choke you to death.
Yeah. It was quick and merciful death.
Sponge car looking things suck.
Yep.
Oh, you! Like, heat seek followed me. That's bullshit. For life.
Alright. Did another full loop here.
Nice. Oh. Alright. Died even worse than the last time.
Ah, hell. Yeah, these level 2 girders are a menace.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they, like, swoop to the bottom super fast. Their back and forth movements are fairly unpredictable. I mean, I guess it is a pattern that one could learn.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that seems to be the case with all of these, is just there's a pattern, you just have to learn it.
Yeah.
Like, apparently it's the same way with, even Space Invaders on this one, there's, like, a pattern of how you destroy them to where if you, like, basically do it right, you never, like, they never get below the screen on you.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I, in our episode where we play Space Invaders, I think I managed to find the groove and get into that pattern, because I was doing really well there.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Well, 41,000 points.
Holy shit, dude. Alright, you're the Megamania champion. I fucking blow dicks at this game.
Yeah, apparently I have a talent for these space shooters, which... It's news to me, too.
Alright, we ready to put this on the list?
Yeah, I think I've seen enough Megamania to form a scientific opinion.
Agreed. Megamania, 1982, Activision.
Yep, you know it's an Activision game because it says it on the screen the entire time.
Yeah.
They want you to know.
They definitely wanted you to remember that it was them.
Yep. Well, I think it's better than Space Invaders.
Yeah, I would say it's a better version of Space Invaders, for sure.
Yep.
Which, I mean, which seems to be exactly what they were going for.
Yeah, they took a tried and true formula and iterated on it, and I think they did a pretty good job. I think it's kind of a similar game to Threshold in some ways, but I think this game does it better.
Okay. I was going to ask if you thought it was better than Stargunner, because I kind of feel it's very much the same, while not like a horizontal, while being a horizontal shooter versus a vertical shooter, it's very much the same idea.
Yeah, they are similar in some ways. I think Stargunner is just a little simplistic with its one or two enemies on the screen at a time, and none of them behave super differently from each other.
Yeah, they're all pretty much the same when it comes to... I agree. It's better than Threshold.
Yeah.
Do you think it's better than Polaris?
I think it's a little better than Polaris. They're both vertical shooters. Polaris, I think, has the constant radar ping, which is obnoxious. And the underwater sections are just a pain because you have that giant hitbox on the submarine and you are, driving through narrow corridors. It's not a very fun experience, I think.
Yeah, it was an interesting idea. It was an interesting change of pace, but yeah, it's they unfortunately did not succeed in making it very fun to do that particular part of it.
Yeah. I think Crawl might be a little better than Megamania.
Yeah, I was gonna say Crawl's a way better game.
Yeah. It has more going on.
It's ridiculous what that game is, but don't get me wrong.
Yeah, and there are definitely parts of it that don't hold up.
For sure.
But I think the final stage where you're trying to break the prison and free your spouse, I think that that has a lot of appeal to it. Yeah, there's just more going on in Crawl. I think Megamania is good, but it's just a little simplistic.
Yeah, and I will say, once I went back and I figured out the thing about being able to beat that particular section of Crawl, it's all about the fact that you have control. You have the ability to aim your shot, a la this game.
Right.
And you use that to your advantage. So
yeah.
And it was definitely I in particular was definitely not doing that when we were playing it for the ranking, but going back and beating it in the little short that I did, very much got into the groove of that. So
yeah.
But yes, definitely Crawl is a better game.
Yep. Agreed. So congratulations to Megamania by Activision. You are our new number 36 best game of all time on this platform.
Yeah.
Good job, Activision. You iterated on a classic and you improved it, and that's commendable.
I'm interested to see if there's an arcade version of that, what it compares to.
Of Megamania?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I don't think many Activision games made it to arcades, at least not...
Oh, really?
...at this stage. Yeah, they were kind of just exclusively a home console publisher.
I didn't know that. Huh.
Yeah, I think it came to, maybe the Coleco... I think Megamania on the ColecoVision is, one of that platform's, standout games. If I'm remembering correctly, I might be thinking of something else, but
yeah, it actually looks like this game only came out for the Atari.
Oh, really? Yeah, I might be.
It did come out for the 8-bit and the 5200, so there might be a better version.
Okay. Yeah, that's quite possible.
Yeah, but apparently there was also it's included in the Activision Anthologies collection that came out for consoles during the like 2002, 2003 era, so like PlayStation 2 PC.
Yeah.
So it's one of those games that is easy to play on other consoles because it's like it's like one of the de facto Atari games apparently.
Yeah.
All right. Anyway, next.
Yep.
Good. Is a game. I forget what game you brought.
Well, this one was an arcade game, and it is a little classic some people may have heard of. It is called Pac-Man.
Pac-Man, interesting. I've never heard of this game that you were speaking of.
Yeah, so it's kind of a weird name. So
super weird.
Yeah.
Did they make a movie about this?
Oh no, that I don't see how that would work.
Okay, for real. Anyway, Pac-Man, obviously the game that everybody and their fucking mom knows.
Yes. One of the most owned games. And I immediately died. I got owned. one of the most owned games on the Atari 2600, I'm sure.
Oh, for sure.
Arcade game came out in 1980. This came out either the following year or 1982. I'm seeing conflicting copyright information here.
Damn, I saw 81 and 82, so...
Yeah.
Somewhere in that era. Area.
So, this version of the game was made by Atari themselves. Much like Space Invaders, they took the biggest arcade game in the world, basically, into their own hands. And, boy, I don't think they did a good job with this one.
Yeah, this is a really not great port.
Yeah, so Pac-Man looks weird with, like... the mouth that opens and closes in horizontally, and then Pac-Man doesn't have a sprite for moving up and moving down. Like, it just uses the left and right facing sprite. And
yeah.
And the ghosts are just a flickering nightmare in this version.
Indeed.
In fact, I think that this version of the game might be the first time they were canonically referred to as ghosts. Like in the arcade game, like it never explicitly calls them ghosts, and people were, you know, they called them like monsters or gremlins. If you like read about, you know, pre-Atari Pac-Man, so they referred to them as ghosts in this version, I think, to explain why they're flickering so much.
Interesting.
Because they are like, phasing in and out, like, like. They're a ghostly apparition.
Yeah.
Also in the manual, it refers to the dots that you were collecting as video wafers.
Video wafers.
Yeah. And I think that should be the canonical name of the Pac-Man dots. I think everyone should refer to them as video wafers. And then the power-ups are power pills, and then the thing that spawns in the middle of the screen sometimes that you can eat for bonus points is a vitamin.
It's a vitamin?
Yep.
This is a really awful port.
Like, yeah.
The controls are really spongy, like, it's really easy, like, you're trying to, like, you want to do the, like, really quick, like, go grab one... pixel, like, one little dot and then, like, run away.
Yeah.
And it's, like, really easy to just not grab that.
Yep.
Because of the way that it looks. It's just really not great.
Yeah.
Wow.
The scoring system is weird. Like, you get 1 point for every video wafer you eat, and then the ghosts are worth, like, I mean, I feel like the... Like, in Pac-Man, the arcade version, and most versions of the game, you get 200 points for the first ghost, 400 for the second, 800 for the third, and 1600 for the last ghost.
Right.
And I feel like that's pretty iconic, and I don't know why they, like, nerfed the scoring system as much as they did. I mean, it's silly to think of it as nerfing, because it doesn't actually matter, but it does make it feel like just a little bit less satisfying to me.
It definitely does. It's definitely not great.
Yeah.
It is. It's really like just everything that's like, this is one of the most iconic games ever, and it's like this particular version of it is just really trash.
Yeah, just a ton of bizarre decisions made, and like the flickering is, you know, it's understandable. It was a limitation of the system, and developers did figure out a way to reduce sprite flickering later on. I'm not sure if you've noticed, but a lot of the games that we played for the 2600 have like a big section at the left of the screen that's just entirely black. Like it's not taking up the full width of the screen, and basically they're not drawing the entire screen because they're using that space as like a little bit of extra video memory to keep the sprites from flickering like that.
Right.
And this was kind of before people figured out that they could do that. So, yeah, it is. I mean, it's just super unpleasant to look at. Like at least Pac-Man doesn't flicker. At least it's just the ghosts. But, like, it is.
Well, what's really awful is it kind of makes it hard to track where the enemies are.
Yeah, it does. And, it makes it hard to determine if the ghosts are still edible or not, because like in the arcade, each ghost had its own distinct color, and when they were vulnerable they all turned blue, and in this version, like, they do change color, but the flickering kind of makes it difficult to tell, like, at a glance if they are still vulnerable or not.
Also, it's wild that there's only one level.
Yeah, which, I mean, you know, the arcade version just had the one maze, but it at least had, like a different kind of fruit for you to eat in each level to make it feel a little bit different.
Did the arcade version only have one maze? I thought it had several.
No, I think Ms. Pac-Man had more than one maze shape. The original...
Maybe that's why everybody likes Ms. Pac-Man better.
Yeah, the original Pac-Man was just the one, the singular maze. Which you know, this maze is shaped differently, of course, being landscape orientation instead of portrait. So the exits are at the top and bottom of the screen instead of the left and right. I mean,
wow. Okay. Yeah, and like, it's way more unforgiving, like, running into the monster, into them.
Yeah.
Like, they just barely have to touch you, whereas in the arcade, like, they basically have to be, like, halfway inside you or inside them for it to count.
Yeah, a little bit less grace, like less grace with the collision.
Well, which is a big deal because the entire thing, like the entire like difficulty of the game, is they get faster,
right?
Smarter, which is what I'm dealing with right now. Like, I'm on like the fourth or fifth iteration of them, and they're like way faster,
right? So like every 2600 game of this time, there are a bunch of different modes that you can play. Basically there are 1 and 2 player modes, and then the what game number you're playing determines how fast Pac-Man moves and how fast the ghosts move. So game mode 3, let me check the manual real quick. So there are modes where Pac-Man moves faster, and that definitely feels better than the default.
Okay.
I'm trying to find which one had the has the ghost moving at the same speed, because I feel like that would be like kind of the most authentic experience, but with a faster Pac-Man. Okay, so game number 1 is slow-moving Pac-Man ghost jogging speed. So if you want the same experience but with faster Pac-Man, that would be game mode number 5.
Number 5.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is game mode number 5. So okay,
yeah, it appears 3 is the is the gimped version of that one. Excuse me, not that word.
Yeah.
The
ghosts move a little bit more slowly in game mode 3. And then
easier version of that.
Yeah, and then game mode 7 is the children's version where the ghosts basically Pac-Man moves fast and the ghosts are just slowed to a crawl.
Oh wow.
And as is Atari tradition, there is a little picture of a teddy bear to denote that this game has a children's mode.
I will say playing it on 5 is definitely feels better. It feels a little more like the arcade in that instance.
Yeah. I mean, it's still not great. Like, in the arcade mode...
I mean, obviously it's still not great, yeah, because, I mean, it's a flickery mess.
Yeah, and so in the arcade, you can sort of, like, preload your move. Like, if you know you're going to want... Like, it's the same problem that Dodgem had, kind of.
Right.
In the arcade, you can, like, hold... You can press right before you come to a turn and you know, sort of buffers a move. And the Atari version does not do that.
Does not.
And, like, I feel like every Pac-Man clone that we've played so far, like Ladybug and Bank Heist, like, they all feel better to play than this.
Oh, absolutely. This is nothing compared to Bank Heist.
Yeah.
Wow, it is wild that their own version... Oh, and I just realized it doesn't, when you die, it doesn't remember how many of the things you ate on the screen. Okay. Oh, oops, that was player 2. Oh, never mind.
Oh, yeah.
I'm player 2. I was okay. Like, what the fuck?
Yeah. Yeah, that would be a tragedy if that were the case. I mean, this game is already kind of a tragedy.
Okay, I mean... I'm not sure I have much else to say that's not, like, really bad about this game.
Yeah, I don't know if there's a lot of good you can say about this game.
I mean, the sound's good. The sound is very... Sounds like the arcade without the music, I mean.
Yeah, and to be honest, I always thought the quote-unquote music in Pac-Man was horrible. It's just...
Yeah.
Like, it's just a wee oo wee oo wee oo, and that just repeats over and over again. And,
Yeah,
this is a more pleasant-sounding game than arcade Pac-Man, I think. Which, I mean, it's still missing, you know, the iconic sound effects, like the waka waka waka.
Yeah.
Also, no cutscenes in this version.
What the heck?
You know, no little... I mean, no charm at all. Like, there's no intro showing you what the ghosts are named, obviously.
And yeah, I definitely feel like this almost feels like a rush job, you know?
Yeah, which, like, I don't know why they did such a good job with Space Invaders, but had so much trouble with this. Maybe they were just unbelievably rushed. You know, Pac-Man was the biggest thing ever, and they weren't expecting it. And when Pac-Man blew up as big as it did, they had to get something out there, and they didn't do a great job. 4,052 points. Like, that feels like nothing.
Yeah.
That is a meaningless number.
Yep. I wonder, how did Namco get like, did Namco just buy Atari?
No, so Namco, so the arcade version in the US was licensed by Midway. So Midway had, like, they distributed the arcade game and everything. So Atari would have negotiated the rights for the home version from Midway. Namco, like, they didn't have a lot to do with Pac-Man in the U.S. Like, Ms. Pac-Man was entirely Midway. Like, Namco had nothing to do with that.
Oh, wow.
So, it was sort of non-canonical. And then,
which is wild, because I'm pretty sure that is the bigger selling game.
Probably.
Of the two.
Yeah.
I'm almost positive, because Ms. Pac-Man is, like, heralded as the better version of this game.
Yeah, that's something that a lot of people think. I think that there's some nuance there. I think Ms. Pac-Man, I don't know. It depends on what you're looking for in an arcade game. I think it's pretty cool that it is possible to get good enough at Pac-Man to play a perfect game of it.
Yeah.
That's not something that I'm ever going to be able to do, but I think it's cool that it's possible. And Ms. Pac-Man adds some randomization that makes it so you can't learn the game as fully as it's possible to learn Pac-Man. Which for the people running the arcades, you know, that's what they want. Like, they don't want it to be possible for someone to, you know, play for hours on one quarter.
But
I don't know. I think it takes something away when you lose that element of, like, total learnability. But Ms. Pac-Man has other, you know, there are other things that are better than Pac-Man, of course. And I think for most people, it is probably the preferred version of Pac-Man. And there is a Ms. Pac-Man on the 2600, which is much better than this. So
yeah, I'm curious. Curious to see the drastic differences.
Yeah, it'll be interesting when we get there. But for now, I think I'm ready to put Pac-Man on a list.
Okay, give me a minute here. I have, like, fucking four more lives because.
Oh, okay.
Pac-Man.
Yeah, I do.
Ah.
This game, it does seem a little bit easier than the arcade version, especially when you play with the faster Pac-Man and the slower ghosts.
Yeah.
It's interesting that you have that option, I think. But...
Ah, poop.
Honestly, even when it's easier, I don't think it improves the experience that much.
It doesn't really. It's just kind of a... It makes these later levels a little less of a... like, pain in the ass.
Yeah.
Anything. Alright. I'll stop here.
Okay.
I got fairly far, so... But not many points, but that's okay.
Yeah. I mean, you can't get many points in this game.
True. Alright.
Alright.
Normal old Pac-Man.
The man of Pac.
It's a flickery mess. I mean, it still works, obviously. It's still a game. It's still Pac-Man, you know?
Yeah. I take it over Coco Nuts.
Yeah. I mean, it's better than Sky Skipper.
Yeah. It's better than that Port of Puyon.
Yeah, that Port of Puyon's really sad.
Yeah.
Commando Raid's not very fun.
Yeah. Is Pac-Man better than Basketball?
Basketball's pretty fun. It's pretty decent.
Yeah, like, it's simplistic, but there's... I don't know. It doesn't hurt to look at.
I don't know. Yeah. I mean, yeah, it sucks that the ghosts are super flickery, but I don't know. You kind of get used to it after a while.
Yeah. Yeah, you usually get used to it.
It's unfortunate.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there's probably a better version of this game in the homebrew section.
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, people have made their own versions of Pac-Man for the 2600 that are playable. I mean, this is playable, but
right.
People have made versions that are fun.
I think it's better than basketball. I think it's better than Chase the Chuck Wagon as well. As silly and cute as that game is just, you know.
Yeah, like the fact...
Go to the end of the maze game.
Right, and I think that as a maze game, Chase the Chuck Wagon, I think I would rather play it than Pac-Man, but the fact that it's possible to get stunlocked, I think severely limits the appeal of Chase the Chuck Wagon.
Yeah.
I mean,
it basically puts a hard, like, limit on how far in that game you can get.
Right. And Pac-Man, for all of its faults, like, it's still Pac-Man. Like, the ghosts aren't as intelligent, but they will, you know, do their best to trap you, and there's, you know, some element of, I don't know, some element of skill, I guess, that Chase the Chuck Wagon lacks.
Yeah.
I don't think go ahead.
I was just going to say that there are certain things you can do in Pac-Man to, like, trick the, you know, the ghost to go one direction instead of the other.
Yeah, and I don't know if the same tricks from the arcade game would apply here, but I'm sure that there are tricks that people have learned that, it may be possible to play a perfect game of this Pac-Man, too. I haven't looked into that, but...
Right.
It seems like that could be a thing. Like, they're not just moving around randomly, so...
Yeah.
I don't think this version of Pac-Man...
Good as Space Invaders.
Yeah, I think Space Invaders, it's a better port, and on this system, it's just a better game.
Yeah, I was gonna say that it probably is going to end up somewhere in that area. It's definitely not better than Mega Force or, you know, and as one note as Star Gunner is, it's still a way better controlling game and just more fun to play. Pac-Man is one of those games that Pac-Man, unlike Space Invaders, personally for me, I can sit down and play a shit ton of Pac-Man. Whereas Space Invaders is dull as shit, and I get super bored of it really fast. But yeah. that's just my personal taste. That scientifically speaking, you are correct that this is a very poor port of Pac-Man compared to a not great port, but mainly okay port of Space Invaders.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think I might... Like, I might be with you. Like, my heart might rather play Pac-Man. But scientifically speaking, I think it has to rank below Space Invaders just because of how terrible this version is.
Agreed.
Like, Space Invaders on this system, for whatever you can say about it, it's true to the arcade game. Like...
Right.
In a way that this game just is not. So...
Yeah, and just the flickering is... You get used to it, but it doesn't make it any... It doesn't make it any easier to track the enemies. And like you said, like, when they're on the threshold of, like, turning back into, like, from edible to not edible, it's, like, really hard to tell.
Yeah, and,
it's just not great.
Yeah, not great. You try it, Atari, and, you failed.
At least you tried.
Yeah. Alright, I'm going to take a quick break, and
sure.
We'll be back with the next game in just a moment.
Cool.
And we are back for more science.
Yep, and we're about to check out my next game. It's a game by iMagic called Quick Step.
Yes, I've never heard of this one before, but we played some really good games by iMagic, so I'm looking forward to seeing what this one's all about.
Okay, so this game is you can either play against the computer or another human. You're the kangaroo, the computer will be the squirrel. I believe. Hold on. Make sure that's not backwards.
Oh, damn. This game is like Sprite Jinx. There was a PC game. I don't know if you remember, but there was an indie, like, freeware PC game we used to play a lot called Sprite Jinx that was just like this.
I don't remember that game, but okay.
You're jumping from platform to platform. You're trying to color them in with your own color. Yeah. Huh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's basically the game. You're trying to color it in with your own color. The colors have meanings. There'll be ones that are, if they're like red or an orange color, then that means when you jump on them, you score 3 points.
Oh.
If they're your color, when they go off the screen, you get 6 points. If they're white, that means they're ready to be done. I forget what the white ones. The white. So there's like a white and there's like a gray.
Yeah.
Oh, then there's occasionally there'll be a gold one that if you land on, you get 7 points and you have what are called tricky traps, which basically you can make a trampoline disappear.
Oh, I see.
The gray ones are not ready to be bounced on yet, but then they'll turn like a whitish color. Which will make it to where you can jump on them, apparently.
Yes, so the gray ones,
Oh, yeah, that's right. You jump on the white one, it'll make you glow for a second. And when you're glowing, if you jump on the trampoline of the other player, it will freeze them in place for a few seconds.
Oh, interesting.
And you get 10 points, and it's a way of killing them.
Yeah, I was wondering what the glowing meant.
Yeah, so that's what you want to do there. But yeah, this game's fairly hard.
Yeah.
I am really not very good at it.
Ah, shit. I fell off the screen.
Yeah, I did too. The computer just whooped my ass.
Yeah. Like, I'm keeping up okay, like, as far as score goes, but...
my ass again.
I'm always falling, like, just behind. We both got stuck there. Oh, damn. Like, I got a bunch of bonus points at the end for some reason, and now I won. I'm not sure why that happened.
Oh, we both died. Oh, I just got stunned.
Oh, I think I got bonus points because the computer ran out of lives before I did. Yeah, so we each have our own live counter there.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. The computer's absolutely destroying me. They're absolutely destroying me.
Yeah.
I'm really not very good at this game.
Yeah, the computer's a beast. Oh, I'm glowing. Oh, eat shit. Oh, you fell off. Okay, well, that works. Eat shit. Yeah, that's right. Aw.
Oh, I killed the computer. Get fucked.
Yeah, it's pretty satisfying when that happens. Hey, stop scoring all those points, you squirrel. Eat shit, yeah. Yeah, fall off the screen. No, you didn't. Oh well. Oh, I'm not doing as well in this game. But you know, scoring points against a computer isn't the be all end all if you can run the computer out of lives.
True.
Because you do get those bonus points at the end.
Sweet, sweet bonus points.
Yeah. Oh, I just got owned. Oh, shit. Yeah, like, I want to stay on the platform for, like, as long as possible, which is definitely not working to my advantage. Like trying to jump off and, like, the split second before it falls off the screen, the timing doesn't always work out there.
Ah, I trapped him and he died.
Nice.
Oh, yeah, I'm kicking his ass this time.
Yeah, using those traps strategically is huge, for sure. And it looks like you have a limited number of them. And I ran the computer out of lives, and I won again. Sweet. This game rules.
Oh, I'm fucked. Oh yeah, I kicked his ass that time. 21,700.
Nice.
Get wrecked, computer.
When you're about to move to the next section and the bottom drops out suddenly, it's real easy. Yeah, real easy to get trapped there.
Mm-hmm. Bap. That's exactly what happened to me. Damn it. Ah, poop. Poop.
You shit squirrel.
You dirty butthole.
Ha! Oh, I froze the computer and then I trapped it. Oh. So satisfying. Oh shit! Oh shit, go up! Oh, I didn't go up. Well, at least we both fell.
Damn it! Oh, now it's kicking my ass this time.
Computer's back.
Oh.
Back with a vengeance.
Just cheated. It fucking spawned me on the bottom row and immediately dropped it out.
Dang.
Asshole. All right.
Oh yeah, look at all these green platforms.
Dirty bubble.
Oh, it's so sweet. Who ever heard of a purple squirrel?
Oh, come on, man.
Get the hell out of here. Squirrel thinks it can take on a kangaroo. What a joke. A kangaroo, an animal known for its jumping.
Fuck.
Unlike a squirrel. You don't deserve the color of purple.
Yeah, I should be purple, damn it.
Yeah. Now, a purple kangaroo, that's an animal. 1782 to 988. My game.
Fuck, computer.
Yeah, once I realized the importance of being, like, the surviving player, the one who doesn't lose all of their lives, the game seems much less difficult now. Like, it's, like, I've won every game so far, so I'm having a pretty good time. I like the font for the score. It's like a funky 70s font.
Yeah.
You don't see a lot of that sort of thing on the 2600.
Yeah, you can really screw the computer if you take out the platform before they get to the where it, like, takes off and goes up the next level or whatever.
Oh, yeah. If you just erase the platform before they can jump there.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a good trick. Like, the squirrel is better at the short game. Like, it is faster at turning the platforms purple before they fall off the screen. But,
yeah,
sure. The player definitely has the advantage in the long game, I think.
Hey, there we go. 1600 to 1100. I pulled it out.
Nice. Good job. I think the sound effects in this are pretty fun. Like the little boing, 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 boing.
Boing, boing, boing. Yeah, and then it's got like the beeping noise, but it's about to let you know that it's like, it's about to like shoot up to the next level. And yeah.
Oh, I was frozen during the transition. Oh, I'm getting owned this time. I think I got too cocky.
Oh, did it actually start? Oh, shit. I thought this was the demo.
Oh. You gotta be quick in quick step.
What the hell? This is like a different game.
Oh, yeah? Oops. Well, I screwed the squirrel, but I screwed myself at the same time.
Yeah, there's like no way to... What is happening? It's so weird.
Oh, well, I lost that one. Oh, well. I bet this would be a lot of fun two-player.
Oh, yeah. Huh. That was weird. Alright, let me look at the manual. See if I can figure out what that was all about.
Did you, like, get to a high enough level that something was different, or...
It was like I changed modes or something, and it like, it was like, let's see. Objective. Left controller pull, game select, lever, A2, here, two player. Huh. It was like the game was like super dumb, and it like, it didn't have any of the, it didn't show how many lives I had. It didn't show, like, I wasn't able to get rid of any of the trampoline things. Like, and there weren't any, like, colored things at all. It was literally just us, like, fighting over the, squares that go off the screen.
Oh, weird.
But the computer kept dying, like, super dumb.
Huh.
Super weird. I don't know what I did there to, like, get that.
Yeah, shit. I don't know. That's weird.
Oh, it's like a demo. Like, okay, so it is a demo. It was like the demo started, but I could control the demo.
Oh, yeah. Some games have a thing where, like, even when the game isn't technically in progress, you can control what's happening on the screen. I just screwed myself. That was bad. Hey,
this is a neat little game.
I won, barely. Yeah, it is neat. I think I'm ready to rank this.
Absolutely. Yeah, I didn't want to start another game because I figured we were about there.
Yeah, quick step. Very interesting. But yeah, look up the game Spry Jinx when we're done, and tell me if you remember that. It's a very similar game, and we played, I wouldn't say we played it a ton, but it was one of the computer games.
I remember that game.
Yeah. I think I liked it a little bit more than you. It was memorable. But, Quick Step, very similar game, and it came first, obviously, so Spray Jinx was probably heavily inspired by it. But
for sure, yeah.
Yeah.
Hell, that's crazy.
I like Quick Step quite a bit. It is a simple but fun arcade game. I think it would probably be a lot more fun two-player, but I think the single-player version is it's plenty fun. Although, towards the end there, I was, you know, it was becoming less of a challenge.
Yeah. I mean, like, once you figure out, like, there are certain times, like, if you worry less about, like, being at the bottom all the time and just kind of pick your spots, but, and try and, like, stay towards the top, especially when you hear the thing where it's about to, like, push up to the next level or whatever, you can basically kill the computer every time by just taking out one of the things below, like, as long as you're above them, and they just end up getting stuck. And you just basically have to run them out of lives.
Yeah. But I do think the strategy involved in using that power well, I think that puts it above a lot of the just straight up arcade style games.
Oh, for sure. Absolutely. Yeah, this game is definitely more than just a, you know, like one note arcade game.
Yeah. Yeah, like I think it's better than Megamania.
Absolutely.
To compare it to a game that we are, you know, freshly familiar with.
Yeah, it's better than Megamania. It's better than Crawl.
Yeah, I like it more than Crawl.
Kool-Aid Man.
Yep.
Trying to think of something that it's one of the games that it's like similar to, and
it's a little similar to Dodge'em. In the kind of one-on-one nature of it, like it's deeper than it appears, much like Dodge'em. And it's fast, like it's really like it feels good, like the controls are responsive, the action is just, it's frantic, and which I think puts it above Dodge'em, because the controls in Dodge'em are a little funky.
Yeah, I would say like controls are super tight, like you know what's happening. Now when I loaded the game up, I had no clue what the fuck I was doing at first, so I definitely had to look at the manual to know like what was happening.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, just me simply saying like these are what this and like the objective of the game, you were easily able to like figure out how to play and, you know, how to win. So it's not like it's a game where you have to have the manual or something.
Yeah, I think it's pretty intuitive. You know, the fact that I still have fond memories of Spry Jinx and I played that kind of game before definitely helped. But I mean, people, even if you played just a game like Doodle Jump or something, like, you know, the basic, you know, the platforming where you just push in the direction and you jump to that platform. Kind of cascading, you know, platforms cascading down the screen. Like it's very, like, I don't think it would take anyone much time at all to figure out what's going on, like, even without the manual.
Sure. And, yeah, I mean, there were just instances where, like, I would just get stuck and couldn't move, and I was like, why the fuck can't I move? Like, what happened? And now I understand it was because, you know, the computer was flashing, and it jumped on top of me, and then it froze me.
Yeah.
You know, that type of stuff.
Yeah, but, that part is a little unintuitive.
Yeah. So, yeah, I would say it's definitely better than Dodge'em.
Yeah.
Like,
I take it over Fast Eddie, I think.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's better than the port of Kung Fu Master.
Yeah, that game's cool. The controls are a little iffy, but
Yeah, just where the enemies kinda like suck to you is
not great.
great, but the NES game also had that issue. So.
Right.
I don't think it's better than Fantastic Voyage.
Yeah. Yeah, Fantastic Voyage had a little bit more going on.
There was that thing where it didn't explain a couple of things, and didn't give you any type of like feedback in playing the game, and like things, a couple of things would happen, like where you would, if you scraped against the thing, then you had to like fight the other, the I don't remember what the hell they were, bacteria or something that would bounce back and forth.
Yeah.
Fantastic Voyage, I would put it above Keystone Capers and below Fantastic Voyage personally.
Yeah, I think you're right. So. Yeah, that seems like a good spot. I'd rather play it than Keystone Capers for sure.
Yeah, I mean Keystone Capers is just. I didn't really care for that game, but I definitely see why people would like that game, and it's definitely a cool aspect. Like, it's a cool game to have on the system. It's definitely not, you know, there aren't other games like that on the system, so it's cool. But it's just, I don't really care for that type of game.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. It is kind of unique, but Quick Step, also pretty unique. It's sort of a, you know, I mean, that's kind of a multiplayer mode in a lot of cases that, you can look at like a game like Splatoon or something, right? Where it's kind of a simple back and forth where you're trying to paint more of the terrain than your opponent.
Right.
Or like, it's like, I think some of the Tony Hawk games had a multiplayer mode like that where you were trying to. You were trying to
like do tricks on a thing, and then like whatever score you got on it would claim it for you, and the other person would have to do a bigger score on it to claim that particular ramp or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it would be painted, quote unquote, for you until someone did a better trick or whatever.
Right. And I think that constant back and forth is kind of interesting. You know, it's like, you know,
definitely.
Sort of capture the flag, but everything is a flag, and you can capture all of it. Like, I think that's pretty.
It's pretty cool, and I think. Sorry to interrupt you, but
no, it's okay.
I think it's one of those games where like, it's one of those games that if you and I were growing up with this system, this is a game that we 100% would have played a shit ton of, like we did with the fucking battle version. The battle royale thing in Super Mario 3.
Oh yeah,
you know, where we would just fucking fight each other and just do that instead of actually play the game, because that was more fun at the time.
Yeah, for sure. And I think this might even be a game that we want to revisit when we are able to do our multiplayer episode. And
absolutely, I think it would completely change the rankings of like. I definitely think when we do the multiplayer thing, we should do an entirely different list.
Yeah.
Just for the multiplayer stuff, and I think this game could very well be very, very high on the top.
Yeah, that would probably make more sense. I was kind of thinking we would just do the two player only games, like combat and stuff, but
right.
It would be like, I think it would be more fair to a lot of the games that are meant for more of a two-player experience.
I mean like, as cool as RealSports Football is, like, imagine that game if it was you and I playing against each other, or like as fun as the basketball game was, you know that game would be more like hectic if we were playing against each other, you know.
Yeah, definitely. Well, it looks like we have more than one multiplayer episode in the future then.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
Most likely. Yeah.
But yeah, quick step, even single player. I think it rules. I think it's a lot of fun.
Definitely a lot of fun.
Is there an exclamation point in the title?
There is.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I did not. Yeah. I didn't catch that. Thank you.
You're welcome.
But yeah, quick step by iMagic.
Yeah, that's. I think that's might be their highest rated game on our list.
Well, I think Laser Gates was iMagic.
Was it?
I believe so.
Man, I keep forgetting that game is iMagic.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to keep all the different developers straight.
Shit, you're right. That is iMagic. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Never mind.
That's okay. Okay. The next game is also one by a developer we have experienced a few times. It is by... it is by Telesis. I could not remember until I looked it up. They made... So Telesis did Star Gunner and they did Coconuts.
Oh. Okay.
And you may see some similarities with this game. Which is called Fast Food.
Fast Food.
Yeah. Oh, I lost my game capture. That's weird.
Uh-oh.
Let me, oh, there we go. So, you are this disgusting-looking mouth.
Jesus Christ, yes.
This horrifying pair of lip gums. And your goal is to eat all the food and don't eat the purple pickles.
Don't eat the purple. Oh, okay, okay.
If you eat 6 purple pickles, then the game is over.
So you're eating everything else but the purple pickles.
Yes. And they may look like eggplants, but the game, the manual does in fact state that they are purple pickles.
So... You're getting fatter. What the fuck?
Yeah. So there's a little like break in between rounds and the game tells you that you are getting fatter for all of this fast food that you were eating. Which is kind of rude. I mean, that's the goal of the game.
Yeah, I'm just doing what the game tells me to do. What the fuck?
Yeah. But wow. I'm not sure if you remember, but Coconuts and Star Gunner also had little breaks where the action stopped until you pressed the button. So
Jesus Christ, this is fast.
Yeah, like that feeling of speed that you had in Star Gunner. Like I almost feel like this could be the Star Gunner engine, just with slightly different rules in place. Like the stuff just flies at you super quickly.
Jesus Christ. That's wild.
Yeah. And I think for every 500 points you get, it takes one of your purple pickles off.
Yeah, I think it definitely was somewhere around there because I had one and then I hit that area and it went away and I ended up accidentally landing on another one.
Yeah. I just lost.
Wow. Really?
719 points. Yeah, I'm not very good at this one. I don't know. Like, it'll throw several purple pickles at you at once, and just at the speed everything is going, it can be difficult to dodge all of them.
Oh, poop! I just got rid of the purple pickle, and then I picked up 2 of them.
That's how it always goes. That's life, man.
Purple pickles.
Just when you think the purple pickle is out of your life, you pick another one up. There are different point values for different foods that you can eat.
Fudge!
I think the hamburger and the sundae might be worth the most. Uh-oh. I just let that purple pickle fly into my gaping maw like a dingus.
So how many are you allowed to get before you lose?
Once you get the 6th purple pickle, the game is over.
Oh, so one more and I lose.
I like that the French fry container has an F written on it for fries.
Nice.
I like that this game has Doritos in it. You rarely see Doritos in video games, except for like the licensed Doritos games.
Yeah. I didn't think those were Doritos. I thought that was pizza.
Oh, you might be right. I don't know. Yeah, they look more like Doritos to me, but
I could see where they're Doritos though, for sure.
Yeah.
Like the way that they're drawn, it could very well be Doritos.
Yeah. Although pizza would make more sense for the fast food theme.
Yeah.
I think I got more points that time. 903, yeah. So much like Pac-Man, the point values in this game are very low.
Yeah.
I think it would have been better if the points were calories and like it actually told you how many calories each thing you were eating had.
Oh, dude, that would actually be really cool.
You could use it as a meal planner. You could be like, okay, one hamburger, one soda, and one fries. That's 900 calories. That'll do me for dinner. I don't know.
I did significantly worse that time. Jeez. But 773 instead of like 1600.
Damn. I think that 1600 is more points than I've ever gotten in this game. I mean, there is kind of an element of luck involved. Like sometimes the purple pickles fly at you so fast it's impossible to dodge them.
Yeah.
It's best to stay as far to the right of the screen as possible to give you...
Definitely what I was doing, yeah.
Yeah.
Stay to the right of the screen that gives you the most ability to dodge.
Yeah, the most reaction time possible. Yeah. Although it is nice that they do allow you to go all over the screen instead of just being stuck in one spot. Yeah, I find that like I do really well right up until the point that I don't. Like the first purple pickle I get, the following ones come exponentially more quickly.
The first purple pickle is a gateway drug to the other five.
Yeah. Once you eat that first purple pickle, you just want more.
I wonder why purple pickles.
I don't know. Like, I don't know if that's a reference to something. Like, I know that, if you pickle something, like some things that are pickled, like, people pickle them with beet juice, and that gives them, like, kind of a reddish-purple color. So maybe that's a thing, like, the developer just didn't like that kind of pickle.
Oh, maybe. I don't think I've ever heard of beet-pickled cucumbers before, though.
Yeah. I don't know if I have either. There are Kool-Aid pickles. Like, some people add Kool-Aid powder to the brine to give it, like, a sweet flavor.
That's interesting. Maybe I could see that.
Maybe it's a reference to that. I don't know. But then I don't know why that would be bad.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know. Some people just don't like sweet pickles.
Yeah. Yeah, that's fair.
Oh, I barely touched that pickle. Boo! Yeah, I mean, like, they're, like, sweet dill pickles and stuff like that, and people don't like those.
Yeah, I didn't like... gherkins. I didn't like sweet pickles for a very long time. Like, as a kid, I didn't like them, but now I'm kind of into them.
Dude, sweet pickles are fucking banging.
Yeah.
They're so good. Oh.
Like,
they're very tasty.
Yeah, I have sweet pickle relish all the time.
Oh shit, yeah, dude.
Like, put it in some tuna salad or chicken salad.
Hell yeah.
Definitely. Yeah, me too. Well, 1150 points.
There you go. Good job.
I broke 1,000.
I got 1484 was what I got.
Ah, okay. Well,
It actually flashes what your highest score is.
Yeah.
Not 1600, but still pretty decent.
Pretty close.
This mouth is terrifying.
It is. I do not like looking at this mouth.
It is. Ugh, that is awful.
Like, luckily when you're actually playing the game, you're sort of too focused on the food to, mm-hmm. like, pay much attention to the mouth. But, like, in between levels, when there's nothing happening and you're just sitting there, like, it makes me not want to look at it.
It doesn't help that it kind of just looks like a flopping, like... kind of like a flopping penis a little bit.
Yeah.
It's like, not great.
With, like, a mirror image of...
Yeah, like a mirror image of it, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I know I said we weren't going to play any porn games, but, This one slipped through the radar. Although we did play another game with flying dicks.
Oh, yeah, we did have, yeah.
What was that, Threshold?
Threshold, yeah.
Yeah.
I've had flying dicks.
Yeah.
All right, we ready to rate this one?
I think so.
Yeah.
I think that's another I don't know. I'm conflicted about it because, like, I'm not having fun.
Right. But it's like, you know, it's just kind of generic.
Yeah.
You know?
Like it reminds me a lot of, you know, the first Telesis game we played, Star Gunner.
Yeah.
I think it's
probably right around that area too, probably.
Yeah.
Maybe a little lower.
Like, it has the same kind of sense of speed as Star Gunner. But I don't know. Star Gunner feels more empowering. Which is very silly because it's a completely fake sense of speed, right? Like, you're not actually flying. Right. It's just the background is flying by really fast. And in fast food, the speed is more a detriment to your enjoyment of the game. But at the same time, it does feel pretty frantic. You're probably right. I think it is worse than Star Gunner. But maybe not by too much.
I was going to say, it actually reminds me a lot of a game that's a little further down, Sky Skipper, in the fact that it's like, it's a perfectly fine game, and it controls perfectly fine, and like, it the sounds are fine and everything else. It's just kind of meh.
Yeah. So Sky Skipper, I think... it is a frustrating game. Like, I think that cluster of games from like 47 to 51, like, they are all, they're frustrating in a way that I don't think fast food is. Like,
okay,
like in Sky Skipper, you have to be super careful. Like, you cannot touch.
That's true. Yeah, not being able to touch literally anything at all is pretty awful.
Yeah, and in fast food, you can touch anything except the purple pickle, which
right. Yeah. The purple pickle.
Oh, we are saying some video game ass sentences in this episode.
Love it.
I'm
looking up purple pickles right now.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. They're just beat. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I wonder if they taste different. Like I've seen pickled eggs that were purple. Yeah.
Oh, It's like a Japanese thing.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh.
It's actually a specialty in, well, according to the internet, I don't know if it's true or not, but it's a specialty in Kyoto.
Ah.
It's called, that's a Japanese word I'm not going to try and pronounce, but it's basically mixed. It's a mix of chopped cucumbers and eggplants that have been salted and brined and red shizu.
Oh. Yeah, so it sounds more like a relish.
Yeah, it's like a, it seems like it's a type of like almost like a garnish.
Oh, interesting.
They put it on top of stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway.
Well,
the more you know, G.I. Joe.
Yeah. I'll have to do some more research into different colors of pickles.
So yeah, the reason why I compare it to Skyskipper, and I agree, Skyskipper is definitely a way more frustrating game. It's just that it's that same kind of just blandness.
And, yeah.
Like, I kind of feel like as silly as in as Chase the Chuck Wagon is, it's still very much the same kind of thing where it's just like, it's just kind of bland. Like, there's just, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's a theme that you don't see a lot in games in general. Like,
that's like, true.
It's slightly more interesting than, like if you had the exact same game, except that you were a spaceship dodging, like, meteors or trying to collect satellites or something, sure. I think it would be an inherently less interesting game just because you see so many games about spaceships.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it's like, literally, it's the difference of, like, one game being space-themed and having a gun, and this being food-themed and just being able to run into 90% of the things you see.
Right. Yeah, it doesn't have the shooting. It doesn't have that action element, which I think takes away a lot. I still think it's better than that port of Pac-Man, though.
Yeah. It's... I could see it being in between Space Invaders and Pac-Man, to be honest. I don't think it's better than Space Invaders.
Yeah, probably not. It's definitely not better than Chuck Norris Super Kicks.
No, Chuck Norris Super Kicks is, while control is not the best thing, it's still more fun.
Yeah. Yeah, fast food. Better than Pac-Man, not as good as Space Invaders.
Okay. Yeah. Sounds good to me.
Good deal.
Science has spoken.
Fast food. So, the reason I'm aware of this game is because there's a homebrew port of it for the Atari Jaguar called Fast Food 64.
Oh.
So, go look that game up sometime if you want a more high-definition version of the horrifying mouth. All right.
Atari Jaguar.
Yeah.
That console's not great to begin with.
Yeah, like the whole idea of an Atari Jaguar port of an obscure Atari 2600 game, I think, is weird and interesting. That game has a first person mode.
Really?
Yeah, where the food is just flying from the background in your direction, and it's a very silly thing, but
wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, it's fun. It's weird but fun. Well, congratulations to Fast Food, the new number 44 best game of all time.
All right, so we have hit our sports game for the week.
Sports.
This one's going to be another real sports entry by Atari from 1987.
Ooh, a late one.
Which is Again, conflicting information. I have 87 or 88. It's trademarked as 87 in the console, but in the game, but everywhere else, internet-wise, says 88. But this is RealSports Boxing. Unlike the other boxing game that we played before, this one is not overhead. This is, what would you call that, 2.5D?
I don't know. It's side view. It is, like, it's not side-scrolling because you can move up and down. I don't know, it's like beat-em-up view. Oh, I'm messing this guy up. Oh, take a rest. How nice.
So I won.
Oh, congrats.
It turns out this game is actually pretty easy. So there are different punches that you can do. Now that I've shown that I can thoroughly kick the computer's ass. So it's all based on hitting the button in a direction.
Ah. So it's like Super Smash Brothers.
Basically. The jab is the thing that you want to use. That's what I use to just get utterly kick the computer's ass. You just hold forward and hit the button. And okay. You basically just pummel the computer in the face with it. And once the little yellow bar underneath gets like to full and flashing, you hit them with a different punch and they just fall to the ground and you knock them in.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's like pretty easy.
Any different punch?
Any different punch. I think you can even use the jab again.
Oh.
You just have to like stop and like hit them again with a punch.
Interesting. Yeah, so my bar was full and flashing, and then the round ended, and now the bar is full, but it's not flashing.
Yeah, you gotta get it flashing. Oh, well, apparently there's something called a payoff punch. Maybe that's what it is.
Okay, yeah, I knocked him out.
Yeah. I guess it's also pushing forward. Oh, it's different. Okay. So you actually hit the button and then push forward.
Oh.
Instead of pushing the button and hitting forward. And so that's the payoff punch.
Is that like a fatality?
I guess it's like hitting select in Super Punch Out.
Oh yeah.
Doing the like and hitting the thing that little Mikey does. But yeah,
you said hit the button and then forward for the payoff punch?
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah, it doesn't seem like when it happened for me, it seemed like it happened randomly. Well, there we go. Oh, but he stood up that time. Okay. So it's not an immediate, like, KO.
Yeah. Well, apparently there are different boxers. Let me get to the different boxers. I didn't know. I only fought that one dude.
Yeah, you can get that bar up real easy just by walking forward and mashing the button.
So apparently you... Oh, okay. You hit L1. Or, oh, L1. Shit. You hit the select thing, and it lets you pick your boxer.
Oh, I see. It's kind of like that shitty wrestling game we played.
And you get to pick who you want to fight against.
Jabbin' Jack, Lefty O'Leary, Iron Fists, and Macho Man. I think that might be infringing on Randy Savage's trademark there.
Right?
Okay, well, I will be Lefty O'Leary, and I will fight Iron Fists. See how different this game is.
This guy is a bit more difficult to... Oh, there we go. Hold on. Oh, he stopped me. Okay. So maybe that first guy is just really easy, and the other people aren't nearly as easy.
Yeah, like, it would be nice if after you knock out the first guy, it would, like, automatically progress to the next boxer.
It would. I agree.
Also, this game definitely has the problem that that volleyball game had with the constant crowd noise.
Yeah. That seems to be a super sports issue.
Yeah. Well, this is real sports, right? Like the same...
Or real sports, excuse me.
Yeah. You can't punch me. I'm wearing a hat. Ooh. Look at all those body blows.
Oh, there we go. I didn't even have... Like, my thing just started flashing. It wasn't even full.
Yeah, that happened to me once. It was weird.
Yeah. That is weird. I don't understand how that works.
Well, I knocked out Iron Fists.
Nice, congrats.
Oh, so I pushed the button and it went on to, like, the next round, but it's still the same boxers.
I don't know.
Also, the silhouettes down at the bottom make me feel like, like, this is an MST3K game.
Oh, yeah.
And they're, like, making jokes about the boxers.
Right. Dang it. I had it, like, flashing that entire time, and I couldn't get him to do the thing to go down.
Yeah. Like, I still haven't determined exactly how you do the knockout blow. Hey, stop punching me. That's not allowed. This is boxing. Show some respect for the sport, please. I like how it forces you to take a rest. Like, you can't press the button and skip past it. You just have to sit there for a few seconds.
There we go. TKO, baby!
Nice.
Took to the second round, but I got him. Or the third round, actually, but I got him.
Come on, knock him out. Come on. I have 23 units of boxing power.
No, that's your score for the round.
Oh. I guess if nobody gets a knockout. Oh, well, apparently if you haven't knocked him out by round three, it moves on to round four. I didn't know boxing could have four rounds.
Yeah, it goes to, normal boxing is 15.
Jesus.
Dude.
That's too long.
Yeah, they beat the ever-living shit out of each other.
God. It's almost hard to believe that's a real sport.
Yeah.
It's pretty barbaric. Alright, I guess I knocked out Lefty O'Leary again. Seemed a little bit more difficult that time, but I'll be Macho Man and I'll fight Jabbin' Jack. It'll be a mirror of the first match. A mirror match, if you will.
I will be Iron Fists against Macho.
Oh yeah, this guy's a pushover. I can just push him over.
Like, for real, just push him over?
No, I mean basically. I like that the sprite for the bell wiggles back and forth when the bell rings.
Oh man.
It's a nice little touch.
Yeah, it's cool. Dude stands up and hits it.
Yeah. Yeah, I have yet to determine how you actually knock them out once the bar starts flashing. Like, it seems completely random.
Yeah, same. Wow, dude. I just kicked Macho Man's ass.
Nice. You should snap into a Slim Jim to celebrate. But don't eat the purple pickle. Hey, fall over. Fall down. Take a nap. What a nice relaxing rest that was. Hey, buddy, fall over. This guy will not fall down. Maybe he's not a pushover.
Who are you fighting?
Jabbin' Jack.
Oh yeah, that's the dude I had an issue getting him to fall down.
Yeah.
It took me to like round 3 or 4 to get him to fall.
Yeah. It took me until round 4. So yeah, it seems like the game modes are just one player and two player.
Yeah, it seems like it. There isn't anything else besides that.
Yeah.
And there aren't any other controls when it comes to, I don't know how they're doing like random stuff when it comes to anything else, but there's a difficulty switch that makes the opponent stronger and more challenging. Want to do
that. Well, maybe I'll try that out. I'm assuming you press the right difficulty switch to make the computer stronger.
Right, yeah, you change it to the A position. Fight an opponent who's strong and challenging.
I mean, it seems like it made him a little faster, but I'm having no more difficulty knocking him flat. Yeah, I don't have a lot to say about this game.
Yeah, it's,
I mean, it's kind of like the wrestling game, except instead of never winning, in this one you never lose.
Yeah, for the most part, yeah.
I mean, as long as you can mash the button. Thirty-one points in that round, and he didn't fall over. Jesus. I'm gonna not punch and see if the computer can knock me out. Like, see how long it actually takes. Why are you backing away? I'm not fighting back. Like, it seems like the computer can't fill their bar. Like, all they can really do is make my bar go down.
Yeah, I mean, they can fill it up some. But it's definitely... But it's definitely not them able. They're just not aggressive enough to be able to fill it up all the way.
Yeah. Like, they keep blocking and like backing up to the corners, even though I'm just standing here.
Yeah, I've noticed that as well. If you don't move from your initial position, they'll just like basically dance around the screen until you move.
Yeah. It's very weird.
Oh, my controller died.
Oh no.
Like, why can't I move?
I choose not to move. I don't care to move. Okay, so once my bar drained completely, the computer's bar started filling again, so...
Oh, well, that's good.
So I guess the bar represents, like, your advantage or something.
Like, you have a... Yeah, like an advantage, yeah. I don't know what else to call it besides that.
Yeah.
Because the other stuff is like the score, where if you go to rounds, like if you fight until you run out of rounds to fight anymore, it'll add up your score, and the person who has the most score will win by a technical whatever.
Yeah, TKO. Like, I have to actively try to let the computer win. Like, I can't just stand here. I have to, like, move close to the computer so that they actually punch me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there you go. That was, like, a nice little string of jabs. Do more of that. Come on, buddy. There you go. You knocked me down. And got a knockout. Good job.
Yeah. I just got knocked out by the computer.
You have to really try to allow that to happen.
Yeah, that was on the harder difficulty, so...
Yeah, I'm wondering if maybe that doesn't, maybe that doesn't take effect unless you reset it or something. I don't know.
Well, maybe. I don't know. I mean, it wasn't really harder per se. Like, I wasn't able to just, like, immediately get up in his face and just start waylaying. But, like, I was still able to continue to, like, combo him a bunch.
Yeah.
It's just he actually actively, you know, hit me as well.
Right. Yeah, I think if the single player actually tries, like, it's impossible to lose.
Yeah, I think so.
So,
it's not a necessarily difficult game.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, I'm thinking maybe this qualifies as broken. Like, in the same way that Glib does, where it doesn't actually check whether your words are real or not.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, it's kind of like that shitty wrestling game, but the opposite.
Yeah, where it's just, like, impossible for you to lose.
Yeah, like, I'm kind of having just as little fun with this as I did with that game.
Yeah, it's definitely not a great game.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm jumping ahead with the science, but...
No, you're fine. I'm ready. I've been ready.
Yeah, yeah, there's just not that much to say about this game.
There really isn't.
Yeah, let's get this on the list.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Like, I wonder if that game would be better two players. I mean...
See, I don't know, because I don't know, like... So, putting it on the higher difficulty, there was a lot of interaction of, like, going, like, me doing, trying to do the thing where you just, like, waylay them on a bunch, and the computer would stop me from being able to do that. Now, I don't know if that's, like, the computer actively, like... Like, it's hard to tell from the animations, but, like, there is a block.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's the computer, like, actively blocking, or, like, the computer just, like, doing something to prevent me from, like, continuing to do that. So I don't know if it's something to where, like, if it was two player, like, and you ran up and started hitting me, and then I went to block, if it would, like, stop the... just, like, fucking onslaught of you beating the shit out of me.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I mean, it's something that we would have to actually play to see how much nuance there is there.
Yeah. So, it may be one of those things where there's like, actively more nuance to it than what it seems like, just because the computer does things so quickly, and there's like, a lot of... the animations aren't, like, super clear.
Yeah.
But I definitely get what you mean about feeling like it's kind of broken, and the fact that it's, like, super easy. I mean, like, on the default difficulty, I literally knocked the computer out in the matter of, like, 30 seconds.
Right.
Like, when I was testing the game, I literally just figured out that you could just continue to beat the shit out of them. I was like, oh, like, you just win every time that way. Like, I literally don't have to do anything else.
Right, but at the same time, it doesn't feel fun to win either. Like,
no.
I mean, you compare.
There's no challenge to it.
Yeah, like you compare it to a game like Quick Step, where we were doing pretty well. We weren't like, I don't know about you, but I didn't like I only lost one of like the five games that I played, but. Like, I felt like I was actually doing something to win. Like, I had to think about it. I had to...
Right, right, yeah.
Like, I had to do more than just walk up and mash the button. Like...
Right, you had to give the... You had to use the entire, like the entire aspect of the game that it offers you. Like you had to like smartly use the traps to like get rid of certain platforms and make it to where it couldn't, the computer couldn't progress, you know, any further so that it would die, or you know, you had to like, you know, try and trick the computer into going into being lower on the thing so that, you know, it would fall, you know, because it was trying to be greedy and get that, you know, jump down or something.
Right. It felt satisfying to use the tools that the game gives you to play well. And I don't, for sure, with RealSports Boxing, I don't know what tools you have other than mashing the button.
Well, I mean, there's other punches, but like none of them, like there's no feedback.
Yeah.
So there's like no indication that like that did anything.
Right.
Whereas, I mean, at least with this like fucking just wailing on them, you have the feedback of the meter going up.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I don't know. I think RealSports Boxing, scientifically speaking, I think it's going to have to be near the bottom of the list.
I mean, I don't disagree. It's definitely, I don't foresee two players changing that any.
Yeah.
I mean, I foresee it being a, we just walk up to each other and attempt to waylay the fuck out of each other.
Yeah. And whoever mashes the button the best is the winner.
Yeah, basically.
It's like,
it seems like it.
It's like the worst Mario Party minigame.
Pretty much.
I mean, that said, I don't think it's as bad as Title Match Pro Wrestling.
No, I don't think so either. I think it's along the lines of like probably the miniature golf, like maybe between miniature golf and minor 49er, 2049er, and the fact that it's like it's not as like fundamentally bad as minor 2049er.
Yeah.
And like the only, like the reason miniature golf is down here is because of the choice that they, because of, well, I mean, it's here for a lot of reasons.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
I don't, like, I think it's like, it's sort of on the same level as Glib, where it's, yeah, it's impossible to lose and it's pointless to play, but I think it's a little bit like, it's worse. Like I would rather play Glib, just because it doesn't have like the constant crowd noises.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Like that's obnoxious. Sure. And I think moving the cursor around in Glib feels better than moving like it feels better than mashing the button. Like I don't like button mashing. It's an action that does not feel good to me. Whereas with Glib, you're just moving the cursor and selecting letters, which is inoffensive, at least. So, I would put I don't know, man. I kind of rather play miniature golf.
That's what I was thinking. I mean, as and like you mentioned how like it feels pointless to play, and I definitely feel like miniature golf is very much that same feeling. It feels pointless to play. It's like one of those things where it's like, sure, you could maybe figure out like you know, the way that they have you hit the ball in a certain way to where it, like, you could theoretically get better at it, but I just don't, like, I don't see that. It's not like with my golf, where it's like it's about like, you know, how much power and like taking in the wind and things like that. It's like, it's just basically, did you fuck up and put it too close to the top of the screen? Welp, you know, you better figure out how to fucking bounce it around to where you can get it to go where you need it to go, type of thing, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I just talked myself into putting this above miniature golf.
Yeah, I can kind of see that. Yeah, like, at least at the end of, like, if you load up a game of RealSports Boxing, like, it doesn't take too long for you to win, and then you have sort of a feeling of satisfaction. I mean, not really, but you're like, oh, I accomplished a goal. I can stop playing now. Whereas miniature golf doesn't really have that. Like, you get to the end and you're like, oh, it took me 40 strokes to get through all of these holes. Who cares?
Right.
So yeah, and RealSports Boxing, it's not as like offensively bad as minor. So yeah, I think
Boxing kind of feels like one of those things where you look at, like, you go to your friend and you go like, hey, I bet you $20 I can beat this. I can beat this game in like 30 seconds.
Yeah.
And it's like that or something, you know?
Yeah.
Where it's just like, you just beat the shit out of the computer and go, all right, there you go, thanks. And then, you know, turn it off, because who the fuck else is, why would you play that game?
Yeah. And maybe, you know, maybe we'll play two player and we'll be blown away at like how much more depth there is, but, you know.
I don't foresee that being the case, but maybe.
Maybe. But for now, for the main list, I think it's our new number 68.
I agree.
All right. RealSports Boxing. Not as good as the other RealSports games.
Yeah, definitely a real downer compared to the other ones, man.
Yeah, and much worse than boxing.
And much worse than like that boxing game was perfectly fine. Like, it was,
yeah, for as simple as it is, it's like, it's well balanced and it's playable, and it feels like it has a point.
That's wild. Holy shit. I did not expect it to be that poor, but yeah.
Well, congrats to Atari for RealSports Boxing, new number 68. Not the nice number, but close enough.
Close enough.
All right. We're already at the last game of the episode. This is my last game, and I don't think this will take us a ton of time either. It's neat. There's not a lot to it. And it is called Cosmic Arc.
Cosmic Arc.
By another iMagic game.
Oh, okay.
So, the sun is exploding in this solar system.
The sun is exploding.
The sun is exploding. And you are piloting this flying saucer, this cosmic arc, and much like Noah and his ark, your goal is to rescue two of every animal from all of the planets in the solar system before the sun explodes. So the first screen is like you're trying to get through like a meteor, like an asteroid belt, and you just push the direction the asteroids are coming from to blow them up, to shoot your laser. Once you get past the asteroid stage, then you hover above the surface of this planet and you press down to launch this little mini flying saucer. After the first planet, the planetary defense forces are activated, because, you know... Because, you know, they don't know that you're trying to save all of these creatures, you know, they just see an invading flying saucer and they try to destroy you.
Oh, no, you don't immediately just pick them up, you gotta, like, fucking... Beam them up, Scotty.
Yeah, so you press the button to fire your tractor beam, and you know, they're running around because they're scared. You know, they don't know what's going on, and sometimes you're not able to rescue them, and you just have to fly away before the
Jesus
asteroid
Christ.
Hits you. But you can try again. So yeah, you have to hold the button for a second to pull them up in your tractor beam, and then once you do that, then you fly back to the ship and take off for the next planet.
This planet has fucking lasers that blow up the ship.
Yep.
Trying to save you, you bastards!
Yeah, like, it would be nice if they would disable their defenses, but they don't. So you have a red bar under your score, which represents your fuel. Every time you get hit, you lose a little bit of your fuel. You get fuel back by rescuing creatures and by surviving, basically.
Aww. So close.
Also, if you manage to rescue both of the creatures and make it back to your ship before the warning alarm starts, that completely refills your fuel.
Oh, interesting.
But that gets increasingly difficult to do. And that's pretty much it. You progress in this manner until you lose all of your fuel. You try to rescue as many animals as possible, and you try to get as high score as possible.
I mean, I'm not gonna lie, this game's kind of cool.
Yeah, I think it's neat.
It's a neat idea, for sure. Ah, son of a bitch.
Yeah, like, I like the multicolored, like, star pattern in the background. I like that the aliens that you rescue actually look different on each planet.
Yeah.
There are a bunch of, like, one of them is, like, a cat, and some of them are humanoids. Some of them are, like, little slug creatures. You know, it adds an element of charm to the game.
Son of a bee.
But inevitably, I kind of get to a point here where the asteroids are just coming too fast and they just hit me a bunch of times. And that's usually where my game ends. Well, if I can... Oh, they're bats now. Or no, they're like little worm creatures. That's interesting. Or snakes. Oh man, that took a long time to beam up. Oh, that sucks. Oh, that's not good. Okay, well, I think I'm kind of screwed here.
What? No, I died. Oh, I guess you come back? Oh, okay.
Yeah, if you get hit, you use some of your fuel to, like, phase out of existence for a minute and then phase back in. So, yeah, it takes a chunk of your fuel, and the game isn't over until you run out, which I just did. I ran out of fuel with 10,170 points.
Man.
And after that, you just start a new game.
Did you say 10,000?
Yeah. Yeah, I usually lose like right around the 10,000 point mark. Like that's kind of the best I've ever done in this game.
Shit. I'm at 7,700.
Oh, that's pretty good. All right, back to the ship.
Shit. I see what you mean though. I'm at the point now where like. Them flying at me is a bit unwieldy.
Yeah. Like, it's kind of... I mean, it's kind of sad. Like, the fate of the Ark is inevitably failure. Like, you're not actually saving any of these creatures because the game always ends in your destruction.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe you're, like, beaming them to a safe spot before you move on to the next planet, but I mean, typically with an ark, you think of it as something that holds, you know, thousands and thousands of animals or people, yeah. Or you know, creatures or whatever. Save the puppies. Oh, I got zapped.
Boop.
Oh, I got zapped again. F you, zappers. No good deed goes unpunished, let me tell ya.
Oh, I lost 9,500.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, this game is kind of cool. I mean, it's simplistic in nature, but not, like, too simplistic. It's different from the other stuff.
Yeah, it has a unique charm to it.
Yeah.
That I appreciate.
I think iMagic has another pretty solid game.
Yeah. Man, iMagic made a ton of good games, and, like, you never hear people, like, singing the praises of iMagic on the Atari. Like, it's always Activision, Parker Brothers, you know?
Or Atari themselves.
Yeah, or Atari. And I'm glad we're able to give iMagic their due in this series, because they deserve it. They made a ton of awesome games.
Very much so. Alright, you ready to put it on the list?
Yeah, I think so. I think we've seen all that Cosmic Arc has to offer. There's a two-player mode, and there's a mode where it's just the asteroid field, and you don't do the planet rescue part, which...
Oh, interesting.
I don't really see the point of that unless you just want to practice or something.
Yeah. I mean, that's an interesting idea as, like, a way to practice. Like, if it gave you the ability to just do that part or just do the, like, abduction part, that could be kind of cool.
Yeah. Yeah, a version without the asteroid field would be nice, but I don't think it has that.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see.
Cosmic Arc.
It's a cool idea, and, you know, it's got a nice little story to it.
Yeah. Like, it feels, like, it kind of feels bigger than it is, the way that you, like you're traveling from planet to planet, and each planet looks slightly different and has slightly different creatures. Like, I think there's a lot to be said for, like, the illusion of grandeur, kind of. I think it's better than Pac-Man and fast food.
Agreed. For sure.
And I think it's better than Space Invaders. It's more interesting.
I think it's better than, you know, this run of, like, shooter, like, kind of meh shooters.
Yeah, it is kind of funny how it ended up with, like, Megaforce through Megamania is, like, the mediocre shooter zone. I think it's better than Crawl.
I think it's better than Crawl. I think it has the same kind of charm where there's a story to it, and you know, gives it more of a more. It's more grandiose than what is just presented to you, because of, like, it lets your mind take, you know, add to the game.
Yeah,
which is cool.
It activates the imagination.
Yeah.
I think it's I would take it over Casino.
Yeah, I mean, Casino is probably one of those games that would be more fun with more people.
Yeah.
But as a single player thing, it is not super engaging.
Yeah.
It's better than Dodge'em?
I think so.
I think so too.
Like, there's more going on. It has a couple different modes. It's sort of, you know, it's hard to compare because it's just such a different type of game.
Right. I think it's better than Stargate.
Yeah, I agree.
Better than that port of Donkey Kong, for sure.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunate. Because Donkey Kong is one of those games that, if it was, like, the proper port of, I could play a good bit of.
Yeah. Yeah, that port is solid for what it is, but not mind-blowing.
Yeah. Unfortunately.
I don't know. I'm thinking, the charm goes a long way, scientifically speaking, to making it a memorable game, making it, a fun game to talk about, kind of. I think it's better than Atlantis. That's kind of a similar situation where, the actual action is pretty simple, but there's some charm to it. There's some story to it. I think piloting the rescue ship and beaming up the animals, I think that's a pretty fun thing to do. More so than shooting.
Yeah. More so than the almost Simon Says-esque. Nature of, or not Simon Says, what was that? Bop It, where you have to hit the direction that it flashes.
Yeah. It's
basically what you're doing by, shooting the asteroid before it hits your ship.
Yeah. Like, that's definitely the weaker half of the game.
For sure.
But, I don't know. I think the overall package is, it's around the level of a Kung Fu Master or a Fast Eddie, I think.
I would agree.
I don't think it's better than Real Sports Football.
No, I don't think so either. I think it doesn't have the type of depth that the games... the games that are above Real Sports Football... Except for maybe Keystone Capers, but that's are all deeper in just or not necessarily deeper, but solid. And Keystone Capers is very much it is a solid platformer. For
sure. Yeah, yeah, and Cosmic Arc, I think it has some cool ideas. I think.
I would put it, I think it's definitely not better than Frontline.
No.
I think Frontline might be the barrier.
Yeah.
Do you think Fast Eddie's better?
I'm not sure. I do think Cosmic Arc is better than Kung Fu Master, just because Kung Fu Master has kind of the wonky controls.
I'm gonna be kind of honest. I don't remember Fast Eddie a whole lot.
So that's the one where you're climbing the ladders and it has the really solid feeling jump. You press the jump button and you can leap over enemies and
Okay. I remember that game though. Okay.
Yeah. I think that game feels really good. And
that game does feel really good. That game was a really solid platformer.
Yeah.
Type.
Yeah. As well. I think it's a little better than Cosmic Arc.
I agree.
I think Cosmic Arc is better than Kung Fu Master.
For sure. Yeah. Kung Fu Master is I think it's the start of the games that have one or two things that really just kind of put it down,
yeah,
on the list. I think that's Kung Fu Master is the beginning of the list of games that have poor controls or annoying sounds or aren't super deep or not a great port in general or that type of thing.
Yeah, agreed. I think with Cosmic Arc and all of the games above it, you can say that they may be simplistic, but what they do really well. And
yeah.
But they're not so simplistic that they fall to the level of a Megamania or something. There's more going on than just a fixed screen shooting game.
For sure.
And I think Cosmic Arc is a good example of that, and it deserves to be in the top 25.
Absolutely. And there it is. Another another iMagic game, like, at the upper portion of our list.
Yeah. And also, was Quickstep iMagic?
Quickstep was also iMagic, I think?
Yeah, I think so. So two more solid iMagic games.
Yep, Quickstep was also iMagic, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, good job, iMagic. They were cranking out the hits.
Interestingly, both games made by, like, programmed by different guys, though. So,
yeah.
Multiple programmers, like, just with kick-ass, you know, really good games.
Yeah.
Wow, yeah. Actually, I just looked at Lasergate. Lasergate's as well. Made by a different person than the other two games as well.
Yeah, they had a stable of awesome talent there.
Hell yeah. I wonder what they went on to go do.
I don't know.
That's a little bit of homework, I think.
Yeah. Hopefully awesome things.
Yeah. Alright, so that's another episode down the drain, I think.
Yes. 72 games on this list.
72 games. Still number one, Riddle of the Sphinx. Still number last in Springer.
Yeah, I kind of hope, like, just for the sake of, you know, interest, I hope we do find some games that are worse than Springer. It would be kind of sad if we discovered the worst game on the platform that early, but...
That would be interesting, but... I mean, it's very well possible that we have, but at the same time, I have to think that there are so many games that were, like, prime examples of the reason why the Atari died in 1983.
Yeah. Yeah, like, there are some games that people think of as the worst games of all time that we haven't played yet, so... Mm-hmm. It'll be interesting to see how they actually stack up.
Yeah, and I mean obviously there's the one that everybody claims is the worst game ever in E.T.
Yeah.
Which most people will readily say is not the worst game ever. And I will be interested to see if when we hit that game, if it is indeed the worst game ever or is not.
Yeah, like I honestly don't know. I've never played the game for myself. I've never looked at the manual, so you know.
Like I foresee, because so I've never played the game, but I've heard things about the game. I foresee it's one of those games where you need the manual to know what's happening.
Yeah.
And it's one of those games where people, like, load it up and go, what is happening? This game looks terrible. This game doesn't control well, and I don't know what's going on. This game's terrible. And, like, never really do anything else. And let the reputation of it speak for itself instead of, you know...
Yeah.
Really doing the science of, like, is this game actually bad? Or was it just the fact that they made millions and millions of copies of that game and they didn't sell?
Right. And, like, I think there's this attitude among people who play old video games of, oh, never read the manual. Reading the manual is for losers. You know, yeah, that's a waste of time. And I never understood that. Like, even when I was a kid and I would get a new game, I would always pour over the manual. Like,
absolutely, yeah. Like, you'd go to, like, you know, the mall or whatever and get a new game, and you wouldn't be able to immediately play the game, so you'd fucking open it up and look at the manual and be like, ooh, that's cool. Oh, wow, okay, what's that?
Yeah.
You know? And you'd, like, fucking, like, yeah, dude. Like, I specifically remember, like, the PS3, Xbox 360 era of when they, like, stopped doing manuals and just being like, oh, that's kind of sad.
Yeah, it was a bummer. And, like, I don't know where this anti-manual sentiment comes from, because, like, even with a new game, like, I would prefer a manual to, like, a super hand-holdy tutorial that takes forever. Like,
yeah.
I would rather read about the game, read how it works, and jump in and, you know, just, you know, teach myself how to play instead of, like, letting the game, you know, take me baby steps through the game. But I'm definitely glad that we are looking at the manuals for all of these games. I think it helps us appreciate the games more, and I think
absolutely, yeah.
And who knows, that may be the case when we get to ET. Like, maybe when we read the manual, we'll be like, oh, this game actually makes sense. But
yeah, we'll have to see.
Yeah, I look forward to finding out. Someone recommended Megamania to you, right?
Oh gosh, yes, I completely forgot to say that. That was recommended by Legend Odinson.
Ah, yeah.
I completely forgot to say that.
Yeah, thanks, Legend. And you'll be playing another viewer-suggested game in the next episode. Here's a list, a preview of some of the games that might come up. And if you have any requests or suggestions or recommendations, feel free to leave a comment.
Absolutely. And you know, we have a section that's suggested two-player games as well. So, you know, those will be ones that we will go through when we get to the point of doing the two-player stuff. So,
yep.
Never fear, if you suggest something that is two-player, then we will we'll definitely get to it.
Yep. And thanks for watching. This has been another super fun episode, and we'll see you next Sunday.
Yep. Later, guys.
Bye, everyone. Take care.